I am now delighted to introduce our two presenters, Natalie Blue and Madeline Pario, and they are from The Artful Life Counseling Center and Studio. Welcome.
Thank you so much for having us. We're very excited to be here. We thought while we kind of put up our slides, we'd just say a couple words about ourselves. My name is Natalie Blue. I'm a licensed mental health counselor and expressive arts therapist and co-founder of The Artful Life. And I've been an outpatient clinician and therapist on the North Shore for just about 16 years. So I've worked in a variety of outpatient facilities such as Children's Friend, Family Continuity, and even Northeast Arc. I'm very excited to be here.
And my name is Madeline Pario, and I am the other co-founder of the Artful Life Counseling Center and Studio. I was just trying to do the math in my head when Natalie was talking. I think I've been in practice since 2007. So yeah, about 15 years. So very excited to do this presentation for you. I don't know if Natalie mentioned she's lives in Wenham. I live in Salem, so we're local here.
We're also both moms.
And we're both moms. Yeah, both young kids. So yeah, we're excited to this presentation, and hopefully by the end of it, you'll have some good sense of what we do and maybe some tools for yourself as well. So the title of our presentation is Trauma-Informed Expressive Arts Therapies with Children and Adolescents. And now I'm going to see if I can move it. There we go. Okay, so we have three objectives today. So the first objective is we are going to answer the question, what is expressive arts therapy? So you have a better sense of what that is at the end of our presentation. The second objective is to help you understand the importance of process-oriented art making in trauma-informed care. And part of that is also understanding what trauma-informed care is. There's some steps to that. Objective three is to explain how the expressive therapies continuum can be applied to children and adolescents. And we'll explain a little bit more about what the expressive therapies continuum is and how it relates to trauma-informed care.
So we're not gonna spend too much time on this, but we wanted to give you a little background about the Artful Life Counseling Center and Studio, if you're not familiar with it. We're a mental health private group therapy practice located here in Salem on Canal Street near the new Starbucks, if you're familiar with that. And Madeline and I have been kind of business partners and we were solo practitioners as the Artful Life starting in 2012. And then, you know, education about expressive arts therapies was really important to us. And we started to kind of spread that message along the North Shore about this particular treatment modality and its prevalence in care for everyone of all ages. And in 2016, we founded the Artful Life as a LLC group practice and hired our first employee. Come now, 2022, we have about 27 clinicians, that includes us, who practice here at the Artful Life. We have provisionally licensed clinicians and licensed clinicians, LMHC, as well as LICSW. We provide some undergraduate and graduate internships, you know, to kind of help with some of our community-based work. And, you know, really at the core of what we do is providing an accessible, affordable alternative to traditional mental health counseling. So accessible, you know, I think it's becoming more accessible, but really when we first started, it was difficult to find someone who is practicing the expressive arts therapies in a group practice. And even those of us were scattered throughout agencies, but people really didn't know we were there. And so we wanted this to be more accessible to to the communities on the North Shore as a treatment modality. We also provide an affordable service. So what that means is, we also are really committed to accepting as many insurance policies as we can, within the scope of our business, and providing other opportunities for people, affordable opportunities for people who might not have the insurance that we accept. And then alternative, which is the expressive arts therapies or more somatic-based treatment modalities that we do here, as opposed to more standard kind of talk therapy and kind of the more basics of CBT, what people are, there's more traditional models. And then also specializing in trauma-informed expressive arts therapies, individual counseling, groups, we do groups here, and consulting in the community. And really that at our goal, the goal of the Art for Life, the heart of what we do is about using the creative process to build connections, for people to build a connection to their internal self, to other people, as well as the community. So what is this expressive arts therapy thing? As kind of growing into this profession, as Madeline and I have evolved our professional identities as expressive arts and art therapists, a lot of times over the years, people think, they're like, oh, what is that? That sounds so cool. It sounds so interesting. And sometimes it's really challenging for people to kind of grasp the difference between art therapy and art making or crafts. And so really what expressive arts therapy is it's about using the different art forms, not just visual art, but movement, drama, music, writing, and other creative processes to really have a non-verbal form of communication to express what's happening internally and within the relationship. I think there are a lot of benefits to expressive arts therapy for individuals, especially trauma, where it's a very body-based experience and being able to kind of communicate what's happening internally. And the arts really facilitate that communication, and they facilitate the growth within the therapeutic relationship.
And we're going to talk a lot more
in depth.
Yeah, about the different ways that expressive arts can be used to treat trauma. So our next section is around trauma in the brain and the use of expressive arts therapies. And I wanted to just review with you all, what is trauma? So I don't know if you've heard the term trauma with a big T, trauma with a little T. We, at the Artful Life, we talk a lot about trauma with a big T, which I think is what a lot of people view when they think of trauma, is kind of those big events. Can you still see me? Those big events, those things that I guess, could be like those, the big traumas that have a big effect. But I think a lot of times what people don't realize is that there's also trauma with a little t as well, that maybe we, for some people, some people experience various different things during their life, and they may not experience trauma because of it. And other people, due to biology, due to environmental kind of chronic conditions, might experience the same event or the same pattern as traumatic. And so we really, instead of really focusing as, we do focus on the event and what happened, but more we focus on how that impacts the body and how that impacts your stress response. So Bruce Perry defined trauma as any pattern of activating your stress response system that leads to an alteration in how that system is functioning, and that leads to an overactivity or an overreactivity, okay? So again, trauma is really about, trauma is stored in the body, right? We know more and more of this from the more recent research around trauma and looking at it more from a psychosomatic point of view. Another definition, again, from Bruce Perry, who's written a book with Oprah Winfrey called What Happened to You? Conversations on Trauma, Resilience, and Healing. And I really love this quote. He says that trauma is an experience, event, and effect that causes an unpredictable, uncontrollable, or extreme or prolonged activation of the stress response. So a lot of different ways that the stress response could be impacted. So that has really been helpful for me to really think about trauma being located in your body and yes, it can be caused by an external event or a chronic or acute distress, but that distress impacts our body in a real physical way, specifically our stress response system. So knowing that leads us to kind of being able to look at, okay, what does that look like? What does trauma look like in the body? How does it manifest? So this might be a review for a lot of you, but I wanted to go over again some of the ways that that trauma can manifest through an overactive stress response. So you've all heard the fight, flight, freeze response. Also, there's been a lot more research around the way that people respond through fawning. So that would be a situation where you're in a very distressing experience and you might over yes that person, or you might be really scared to say no, and so you say yes. So you have a lot of sexual assault victims feeling very guilty that, okay, why didn't I say no, or why didn't I fight back harder? But that is an actual stress response to protect yourself, to try to just kind of get through that situation. And it can manifest itself outside of that stressful, acute experience by then continuing to yes, people please. I don't know if you've ever, I know with my kids, I might, you know, ask them a question in the morning and I might be, you know, I might be frustrated, right? And say, oh, why aren't you getting your shoes on? Where are your shoes? Are you getting ready? Yes, I'm getting ready. Yes, I'm getting ready. Right. And they're kind of, they're catching up to my stress and responding in kind of that yes response, even though they might just be sitting there. Right. And we can get really frustrated. But that's just a little bit of, it's not necessarily a trauma response, but it's a stress response, right, that we see even in kids of yesing someone to kind of get out of, you know, hopefully get out of being the target of that anger, right? Fidget and fumble are also things that we're looking for, right? So that distractedness, the stress response we know shuts down the prefrontal cortex and makes it very difficult to use that executive functioning the way that we would like. So you have kids distracted, you have adults, you know, unable to focus. So these are all, this is again, a review of some of the ways that trauma impacts us chronically over time. And so Natalie's going to talk a little bit more about how do we care for this? How do we treat this? And thinking again about the stress response, that system is called the sympathetic nervous system. When that's activated, right, that's the gas pedal. And that's activating a lot of systems in our body to keep us alert, to act quickly, hypervigilance, right? But over time, chronic stress can really impact our body. And so what we're looking for with trauma-informed care is to find ways to activate the parasympathetic nervous system, which is the brake, okay, which is slowing things down, reactivating the prefrontal cortex, helping us use some coping skills in order to calm our body down and be able to combat those adverse effects of stress.
So when we talk about trauma-informed care, there are some pretty specific elements that we are considering. I feel like the idea of trauma-informed care is being used in a lot of different settings, not just counseling ones. You know, there has been a real, a lot of work being done about how to add this lens into schools right now as well. So the idea of trauma-informed care is really a whole person approach. And the idea is that, to what Madeline was saying, that we're looking for ways to activate the parasympathetic nervous system, the kind of rest and digest kind of part of our body, that stress response, to really kind of calm and soothe and balance out kind of the more hyper alert pieces of the sympathetic nervous system. And so trauma-informed care is a very comprehensive view, and we're looking at a lot of different factors that are affecting a person that go beyond just the behaviors that we often see, especially when we think about kids. So, we're understanding kind of the neurological and biological impact that a traumatic event or a traumatic response is having on a person in the moment. And also thinking about, the kind of short-term and long-term psychological and social effects that trauma and violence can cause. And again, to Madeline's point earlier about big T versus little T trauma, it really is in response to the individual that, a large trauma in someone could have a smaller response than the difference between, a sexual trauma and, a fender bender. Depending on the person, they could have a very, activated response to a fender bender and vice versa. So there are five elements, and we're going to go into them in more detail. And Kathy Melchiotti, if you're not familiar with her work, she's a well-known art therapist, expressive arts therapist. And she has really been at the core of taking the trauma-informed care approach and combining it with the expressive arts. And so we're going to be looking at her work as well as some other expressive arts therapy theories. So really the five primary elements, I'm just going to kind of go through real quick, is about establishing a sense of safety, regulating affect, and to add on to that, co-regulating affect, reestablishing attachment, enhancing the brain's executive functions, and being able to reframe and, most importantly, integrate traumatic experiences so that they start to function on more of a memory basis as opposed to a happening in the moment basis. So we're going to go through each one of these in a bit more depth. So again, Kathy Melchiotti incorporates a lot of Bruce Perry's work. So the idea is that we're taking a neurosequential approach via expressive arts therapies to stabilize the body's response. So if you're unfamiliar with neurosequential model of therapeutics, it really is an approach, it's not a theory. And the idea of, which is developed by Bruce Perry, and the idea is that we're looking at brain function in terms of when the trauma occurred. So if the trauma occurred, if you're working with an adult or an adolescent, if the trauma occurred in early childhood, we're really thinking about trauma in the adult as when it developed. So we look at this neurosequential approach to the brain, that the child, that someone's history and their current functioning and when the trauma occurred is going to impact their present day response. So if it happened when they were a child, they could be responding at the developmental level of a child. and that the trauma is somehow lodged in that part of a person's development. So, you know, this is a bottom-up approach to trauma, a more somatic-based approach to trauma, as opposed to like a top-down one looking from the prefrontal cortex, trying to make meaning. And the idea that we need to, again, in order to activate the parasympathetic nervous system, that we have to work with the lower brainstem, you know, those kind of primitive parts of the brain and development to kind of connect to the nervous system and have a more sensory motor response to kind of activate attachment and activate self-soothing before we can do anything else, whether it's explore emotions, that if safety comes from the lower parts of the brain. And in order for us to feel safe in our bodies, if you're someone who's experienced trauma, you need to be able to activate the lower part of the brain so that you can calm your nervous system. And there's a lot of wonderful ways that expressive arts therapy can do that.
So the second component of trauma-informed art therapy is to identify the body's reactions to stressful events and memories through trauma-informed evaluation and sensory-based activities. So going back to understanding the fight or flight response, trauma-informed therapists really need to have a robust understanding of the stress response and how that can manifest in individuals. It doesn't always manifest the same way. For some people, it might manifest as more hyperarousal. So that is more of the overreactive responses, unclear thought, emotional distress, and just the inability to calm down. So the hyperactive, hyper response, panic attacks, it could manifest also as anger as well, as extreme defensive responses, hypervigilance. Okay. That is in the hyperarousal range. For other people, it could manifest as hypoarousal. That is, that shows up as more depressed symptoms, lethargic, low energy, feeling numb, unmotivated, checked out, shutting down. In extreme cases, it could be dissociation. Okay. And so in those first stages of assessing an individual, you're looking at, you're working with them to notice how is their body responding? How are they, what is their presence in the room with you? How are they able to stay present? Are they able to stay present? I often use just a simple measurement of their hand, of helping me understand how present they are. This, the hand right in front of their face is 100% present. All the way back here is not present at all. And I just have them sometimes show me, because they might not be able to verbalize it, kind of where they are, right? And sometimes they might be over here, you know, over here. And so then we might engage in activities to help them be more present, be more within their window of tolerance. For someone who has experienced trauma often, more often chronic trauma to the nervous system over time, their window of tolerance is very narrow. That green is a very thin strip. Anything slightly above or below, and they start to, their stress response starts to overreact, okay? And so a lot of what you're doing at the beginning is helping them stretch that window of tolerance. Okay. So sitting within just kind of that line, that arrow where that arrow is pointing, not going over. Okay. So using mindfulness to breathe through, helping them understand, you know, breathing is a skill. I actually tell people breathing is a skill. You wouldn't know it, but, being able to do that deep breath work or the mindfulness activities, being able to have that focused attention to something in the present moment, that takes practice. And so I'll teach them some of the basics of mindfulness, some of the basics of breath work, grounding, and we might do some art to also help tether them to the present. We might do guided imagery, guided relaxation, progressive muscle relaxation, some of this kind of basic stuff. I might give the example and actually try it with them of holding an ice cube in their hand and seeing, okay, we know that it's uncomfortable, that ice cube, but we know that it's not going to actually do any permanent damage. It's going to be okay. And the longer that we hold that ice cube in our hand, what happens? It starts to melt, starts to become more fluid. So there's a lot of different ways that you can help people expand that window of tolerance, help to feel building that safe sense of safety, as Natalie was talking about, and helping them stay more in the green.
So with children in particular, you know, children have, you know, limited, depending on the age of the child, limited access to language. You know, their abilities for abstract thought are a bit more, again, kind of limited as opposed to adults. However, so what we're looking to do with kids is, many times when it comes to this trauma-informed approach, is really helping them to connect to their body. You know, I think that's part of why we see a lot more kids, if they've experienced trauma, being hyper aroused, is because their bodies they're not attuned with their body and the information that their body communicates to them on a somatic level. And so a lot of the work that we're trying to do, like, you know, in terms of finding this balance between the parasympathetic and the sympathetic nervous system, is about helping kids, helping teens, helping adults kind of tune in and listen to their body and listen to and by listen, I mean, really feel into the sensory parts of their body. And, you know, if they're having butterflies in their stomach, if they're feeling jittery, some people they're almost, you know, I feel like an image that's really useful, the idea of like a balloon kind of on a string. Imagine someone with trauma, it's as if their head is a balloon kind of just floating above their body. And the connection between the body and the brain is very thin. And so being able to, you know, the way that we know what an emotion is through the sensation. And so, you know, one of the components is like, how do we respond to the body's reactions? And, you know, a lot of the work that we do with kids through the expressive arts is teaching them to be able to read these somatic and sensory approaches to regulating their body and notice understanding their body. And these are some really basic ideas for helping kids do that. Some really great kind of active, engaging activities for, you know, giving your body the green light, the idea that you're in a healthy window of tolerance space. So again, and for kids, you know, the idea of sitting down and meditating doesn't usually work. I know you see pictures of kids like doing kind of that Om pose, but really for kids who have lots of wiggles, and even anyone who's experiencing trauma, it's really hard to like sit still. So these are activities that can engage a child in a physical way to gain some understanding about what's happening in their body and be focused in the present moment that are really focused on more somatic awareness. So we have the five senses countdown, blowing bubbles, you know, really grounded, strong yoga poses, you know, playing certain games. Madeline mentioned before progressive muscle relaxation, but even freeze dance or stretching or red light, green light, those are progressive muscle relaxation activities. If you kind of take them in a broader sense, they can be used that way. Again, you know, we're looking for we're looking to integrate and connect. So we want to activate the prefrontal cortex. And so really simple games like Simon Says or I Spy or simple math or spelling questions are a way for someone to stop in the moment and kind of turn their brain back on and be like, okay, I got to think of something. And it takes us out of the body and it puts us in the present moment. And then this idea of kind of assurance versus reassurance, reassurance is actually not very reassuring for a lot of people when someone says, oh, you're going to be just fine, or you should relax or calm down. And the idea that when someone's feeling really activated in their body, what they're looking to know is A, that they feel safe, but that they're going to get through what's happening. So assuring someone that like what's happening right now is hard and challenging, but there will be a next step.
So the fourth component is going along with what Natalie was saying, is to reinforce a sense of safety through reconnection with positive attachment and self-soothing. So after you've established a sense of safety, basic safety, and assessed where are they at in terms of the window of tolerance, what does their stress response look like? There is a real power and a need, a necessity for our bodies to connect, right, to other people, to have a positive attachment. And actually there's research around why some children or adults, teenagers or adults, respond differently to similar stressors than others. And one of the big factors, protective factors, is connection with other people, helping the other people in their lives, helping them make sense even after the traumatic event, to help guide them through that and create a strength-based narrative of what happened to them. So having a positive attachment with someone else, being able to mirror the calmness and the soothing that they might be witnessing from a positive attachment is extremely powerful. So art, we use that a lot in art. We think about art perhaps as, we call it the third hand, that it's, yes, it's, it can, in some ways, it's a way to witness yourself, exploring your feelings and emotions. And then with another person, it could be with a therapist. Sometimes with younger children, we invite the parent to do dyad work together, sitting side by side. A lot of this early work in just maintaining and creating a sense of safety, establishing a sense of safety, is the focus is not as much on the content, and it's more on the process of creating together. And we help the parent and the child, or in some cases the client and with the therapist, to really slow down the movements, focus on attunement with the other person, to create a way of listening to each other nonverbally. So being aware, curious, and there's also something really powerful in having a witness to what's coming out, having someone who is non-judgmental, witnessing what you are expressing. There's something really, really powerful about that. So that is a way that art can be, again, part of the way of activating that parasympathetic nervous system, slowing things down. We also might combine the breathing, the mindfulness, into this next stage of art making together.
So finally, the fifth component of strength building by using the arts to normalize and enhance resiliency. And this is, you know, as you can see, we're kind of working through this bottom-up approach to help someone make meaning of their experience and start to see that they have some strengths and that they can access those strengths and have awareness about those strengths and find ways to access them outside of counseling, and that the arts really helps with that. And so I'm going to show you an example of a piece that a client of mine did. This is created by an older adolescent who, you know, had been experienced depression, had early trauma due to some medical experiences, struggled with learning difficulties and ADHD, bullying, parent divorce. And, you know, really this person felt really low inside. And so we did this comparison about what they felt like in their body. And you can really see, you know, and what they were currently feeling like in their body and what they would like to feel like. And so you're seeing this use of the art materials and a way to show, you know, what currently exists. And even, you know, you can see that there's this little smiley face inside this, you know, darker body outline with this drooping head and the hands in the pocket, like this very defeated kind of hopeless looking pose, but really there is this center of hope. And, you know, in the next phase, which you can see looks like a much younger drawing that a younger child would make, and this was made by the same person, that kind of hope and kind of happiness is kind of spread and these colors have taken over. They're outside the body. You know, that kind of emoji face is now within the head. And the idea that you can use the arts to, you know, and now talk about this is like, what do these colors feel like in your body, and building awareness of what it would feel like, you know, what kind of activities you would have to engage in to like feel this vibrancy in your body. And I think you're really seeing that kind of vibration and kind of hope that someone wants to experience and what they're currently experiencing.
So hopefully at this point you have a sense of the five components of trauma-informed care and how that relates to trauma-informed art therapy. What we want to talk about next is a theory that is specific to expressive therapies called the expressive therapies continuum. And it really builds on all of the theories and approaches that we've discussed, specifically around the neurosequential approach that Natalie mentioned from Bruce Perry, using specific media, approaches, processes that are neurosequentially based to work with where people are at in processing their trauma. And based on, again, how they specifically are manifesting that with their trauma response. So again, it's so this is a theoretical framework. It looks at developmental sequence of information processing, the way that we process information. Typically as a child, it's more simple, and then it becomes more complex as we get older. And that translates in media to more of the simple kinesthetic experiences on one end, and then on the opposite end, more of those complex symbolic images. So again, remember what Natalie said is we're really looking at when the developmental age, when that trauma happened, is when that's what we're really focusing on and looking at when we're thinking about materials. So we'll come back to this image, but just to kind of think about that the goal here is when we're looking at all of these things that we will be going over in detail in the next slides, that the goal is the integration of all of these six components, okay? And the way that it's laid out here is to, if the way that you want to think about it is the earlier developmental, I guess, spectrum, right, that we're looking at is kinesthetic and sensory. Okay, then the next level is perceptual and affective. And then the last level is cognitive and symbolic. That's really more around the prefrontal cortex, right? Whereas the middle is more maybe the midbrain, and the kinesthetic and sensory is more of the limbic system, brainstem. Okay, so we'll go over all of these three levels right now.
So really there, we want to look at what are the therapeutic benefits of the expressive arts by thinking about the continuum when we're working with clients, with children, with adolescents, and what we gain from like information about someone's development, what has occurred in their life, what their current presentation is. We kind of think about these levels and how to apply the arts to kind of help that person kind of grow. The first level, each level is a spectrum. And again, we're trying to find a balance between the levels. And so the first level is sensory kinesthetic, you know, which we've kind of, you know, we've been talking about, and the idea that you're using art materials, you're immersing in the sensory experience of art making. So really what you're looking for are things that are self-soothing. And the affective perceptual is about kind of, again, connecting with the limbic brain region, the amygdala, which is, you know, the kind of source of kind of fight or flight and all emotional processing, and, you know, using the arts to find an emotional release, to do some grounding and expression about someone's emotional experience. And then finally, the third level, again, is connected to the prefrontal cortex. And this is where we're using art in a more cognitive and symbolic way. We're looking to problem solve. We're looking to make meaning. We're looking to kind of, do some restructuring with cognitive distortions and, beliefs that people have about themselves, whether they're negative beliefs or negative self-talk. And these are ways that we can process that.
Mm-hmm.
You go on the next slide.
Yeah, and just notice, I know there's some questions and we will, I think we'll have plenty of time to go over any questions that you have in depth.
So these are just some kind of basic examples of sensory and kinesthetic art making. So again, deep breathing through the arts, mixing colors, working with paint, actually, you know, using like a really large paintbrush, and on one brush stroke you inhale and on the other one you exhale. Anything that's like rhythmic or physical, molding clay, music making, tearing paper, pounding, mark making. You're not really making anything specific. You're just engaging with the art materials in a way that are repetitive, and just kind of a general sensory piece of the materials that you're engaging with. You know, making slime, working with sand trays, exploring textures and colors, anything where you're kind of like using a very hands-on, present-oriented, you're looking to use the arts to be in the present moment. Even if, you're seeing a picture of watercolor and shaving cream and kind of swirling the color into the shaving cream. And then ultimately you make, you do printmaking this way, but even like shaving cream on the hands is such a soothing experience. Mm-hmm. Like the materials are very gentle and are aimed towards calming the body and soothing the body.
And I was just going to say with this one too, is this, we're talking about working with children, but we're also talking about really working with the developmental area of stuckness, right? And so I've actually had teenage clients, adult clients who are too in their head. They're too, you know, they're very hyper aroused, very hyper vigilant. It's hard for them to access their body and really understand how they're feeling. They're very much in their thoughts. And I've I've done some of these sensory, you know, we've done some of these sensory experiences with older individuals because they needed something to facilitate helping them slow down, notice their body, connect to their body, that maybe is easier to do it using some of these self-soothing art materials than, okay, let's sit and focus on your breathing. Let's do some belly breathing. So this is another tool to help develop and practice mindfulness skills for all ages. The affective perceptual is, as she said, it's more of like that limbic area, the amygdala area that we're really working on. It's helping, again, with that self-soothing, but also even more of that connection between your emotional state and how you perceive that emotional state. So you're building that emotional intelligence. You're starting to identify the expressed feelings and emotions. You might be role-playing different emotions, different characters, to express different parts of yourself. This is where we might talk about parts of self. Art making while listening to music can really bring out some of the emotive, affective qualities that you need to feel. We oftentimes, when trauma gets stuck, it's because we haven't been able to, maybe at that time didn't feel safe enough to fully go through the full both stress response and the activation of the parasympathetic nervous system afterwards to help calm and soothe. And, oh, I'm no longer in danger, right? So sometimes we need to help our body catch up to help us understand we're no longer there. That was then, this is now. We're not in that dangerous situation anymore. Body mapping, helping understand where our bodies are in our body, physically, what they might look like. And it's a way of using art materials to promote curiosity of yourself and others. And like I said, again, it's an orientation of time too. You're being curious and understanding, oh, wait a second, that was then, this is now, that was me now, or that was me then, this is me now. And then the cognitive and symbolic spectrum is really integrating now into the prefrontal cortex. So it's taking all of that knowledge around your feelings and emotions and making more, it's more meaning making. It's what I call flipping the script, changing the narrative, that those old messages. And we often say, if you can imagine a change, right, then you can change, right? You need to imagine it, be able to imagine it first, visualize it first, make decisions creatively that you can then, you know, practice in session, practice with the art making, and then apply it to your outside life. Storytelling, visualization of safe and calm experiences, and again, changing the meaning or making new meaning of what happened to you. And then the goal, as we said in the beginning, is the integration of all of these components. Ideally, we want to help individuals flow between all of these different ways to express and connect to yourself. We are looking for areas that someone might be stuck in one area than another, right? We might have someone, you know, we see the kids who can't stop moving. They're stuck in the kinesthetic experience. Or it's just individuals who might be so overwhelmed by their emotions, right? And their affect, And so we want to help people be able to flow between all of these safely. That builds resilience, emotional regulation, insight and awareness, creativity, adaptability, and confidence.
So we'd like to show you an example of something we've been working on for years that that we use with youth in groups. And we've done this program for several years and are currently doing it at the Salt and Stahl School here in Salem. In addition, we're doing some other trauma-informed expressive arts groups in Salem. However, they're with younger children. And so this particular, so we tend to do much more sensory, you know, we follow the continuum, but we tend to keep things in the sensory kinesthetic area because we're looking to kind of promote that safety and building that kind of security and regulation in the body. So this particular program is called, it's a trauma-informed approach of a layered painting project. And so it's a process-oriented group. We call it the Revolution Evolution of Me. And so what it is, you know, kind of technically and artistically, is that we work with youth and everyone gets a single canvas, kind of a large canvas, not like a little 8x11, like something like 16x24. And what we facilitate and guide youth through is creating multiple paintings week after week. However, the paintings exist on the same canvas. So really what they're doing is they're layering over one painting. And so we use the different weeks and the different layers to explore the continuum from the sensory kinesthetic through to meaning making with each layer. So we tend, you know, we do explore a lot of different types of materials, you know, kind of two-dimensional materials from like paints and paint mediums to found objects and collage and tissue paper. There's a lot of things that we have youth explore in terms of the materials. And so they're getting this very multimedia experience. And it's really, the idea is around the layers is like, we all have layers, that idea of, you know, onions or, you know, even developmentally as we age chronologically, like we get more and more experiences in life. Those are layers. And so we look to metaphorically explore a person's narrative through the layers. Like, what are the parts of yourself that you're willing to just like show to everyone? What are the things that you cover up? And so again, we put them into the layers. And so earlier layers, there's things underneath that you might not see in the final piece. The other thing that we do as we create this, so you can see in the next slide, here is we photograph every single layer. So each layer is photographed from the first through the final. And so you can see here how this piece has changed. You know, you have these like birds up in both sides. And then you see in the second layer that on this side, it's now super dark. And there's a sun and the birds are now white. When we go to layer three, we have the black is gone and we have white and we have a face that's crying in a cloud and the sky and the sun have darkened and so have the birds. And then on the final layer, here we have you know, a lot more going on with you know, we have a lot of collaging going on into the middle and things that are more about meaning making. And so when we photograph each layer, when we've finished our project, we usually hold an art exhibit. And the art exhibit will have all the final paintings that have been created. And then we turn these pictures into a time-lapse video, so that you can see the evolution of the layers from first layer to last layer.
So here's some examples of the use of sensory and kinesthetic art making and movement on these canvases. So you'll see movement, directional mark making, splatter, and tissue paper, which they were tearing and scrunching. So these are just examples of that first layer that we focus on. And the second layer, affective and perceptual, is more about adding some of those elements that are more emotionally, not just emotionally expressive, but connecting more of that meaning to those marks. That it's just not just marks now and movement, it's representative of feelings and emotions. And then even more, looking at, okay, so now what is the story? What is the full narrative, cognitive and symbolic? Really thinking about what is my artist self want to express here? And we actually have people write mission statements or artist statements about their art. This maybe people add more words to their art, and more of that use of symbol and metaphor. And now we have a video that hopefully should pop up. Here we go.
So this is an example of the video that we talked, this time-lapse video, so that you can see an example of the layers and the evolution of the painting. And this is from a group we did last year at Beverly Middle School with their inclusion program for sixth and eighth graders, and exploring their identity through this process.
Thank you.
How do I go to the next one here?